Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Andra Gillespie. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Political Science. I focus on race and politics in the U.S., and today I want to talk about the idea of movement or moment. Last week I happened to be watching CNN, and Roland Martin asked the question about whether or not 2008 was just a moment or whether it was the sign of a movement. And that has implications for both voter turnout and for how we think about how race and politics are unfolding and the viability of black candidates like Barack Obama going forward. Right after the election, the Christian Science Monitor published an op-ed piece where they suggested that the 2008 election was a game changer, that young people were going to be involved in the electoral process and in government in ways that we had never seen before, and we were going to see a resurgence of civic life in the United States. Similarly, right on Inauguration Day in 2009, Gwen Ifill published her book, The Breakthrough, where she said that Obama was the harbinger of a new generation of young black political leadership that was not defined by race and that was progressive in its politics. Nearly 2 years later, we can look at some of the folks who are constantly mentioned and commonly mentioned as being harbingers of this new black political leadership, and their political fates are largely changed. So, for instance, Harold Ford had to abort a Senate campaign in New York this year. Kendrick Meek will lose on Tuesday. I have no doubt about that. It is still in question whether Deval Patrick is going to win re-election as governor of Massachusetts. Adrian Fenty lost in the Democratic primary in Washington, D.C., and Archer Davis lost his bid to become Alabama's first black governor. So the question is, where did all the promise go? So I want to talk about the factors that will help predict turnout in this election, and then I also want to talk about young black politicians and what the Obama generation actually now looks like now that reality has set in. So first, there's some basic facts about voter turnout that I want to get out on the table. One, if we look at voter turnout for the last 50 years, basically, we shouldn't expect that there's going to be particularly high voter turnout in midterm elections. As you can see, for the last two midterm election cycles, voter turnout has hovered around 37% of the voting age population in the United States. So about 37-38% of all folks who are over 18 in the United States turned out to vote in this particular election. There are local spikes around wave elections except for 2006. So for instance, turnout's about 39% in the 1994 Republican wave, and in the turnover in 1982, we also see turnout hitting just at 40%. As such, I don't expect voter turnout to be particularly high this particular election season. So if we get 40%, that's a local record. If we get 45%, that's astounding, but that's still pretty bad voter turnout. So just remember that when people talk about record turnout and record early voting turnout, it actually really doesn't make much sense, and I doubt that we're going to see anything particularly different on Tuesday. We know from the literature on voter mobilization and on political participation generally that while certain factors like a person's education status or their income do predict their likelihood of turning out to vote, mobilization is key. And one of the reasons why we've seen low voter turnout in not only midterm elections but also presidential elections in the past 50 years was that there was a shift away from direct personal mobilization to indirect and impersonal forms of mobilization. So for instance, people stopped knocking on doors and asking you to go out and vote, and they started to ask you to do it on television and you didn't get the message. So one of the things we have learned in the past 10 years is that personal direct mobilization is the best method of voter turnout. In particular, canvassing is the best thing to do. And so part of the reason why we've seen an increase in voter turnout in the past 10 years is in part because campaigns and nonpartisan groups have gotten the message and they have resumed their canvassing activities. One of the good things about canvassing is that it has a residual impact in subsequent elections. So if you were canvassed in one election, it increases the likelihood of your turning out, not just in the election for which you were canvassed, but also in subsequent elections. And so that's a good thing. And so part of the reason why we've seen increased voter turnout in presidential elections is because there's one, increased mobilization on, you know, directly in person, and then also because there's a residual impact of that. Just because that's the case, though, we shouldn't assume that there's going to be some residual effect from 2008 carrying over into this election. Barack Obama won in part because he had superior field operations, but that's not saying a whole lot. So for instance, in October 2008, the Hotline and Diageo released a poll where they asked likely voters had they been contacted by either of the two party campaigns. And 14% of the voters said that they had heard from the Obama campaign, 7% said that they had heard from the McCain campaign, and 12% said that they had heard from both of them. That's still less than a third of the likely voters, which means that two-thirds of these folks hadn't received any contact at all. And so what that means is that the record turnout that we saw in 2008 was probably an artifact of self-mobilization than it was any concerted effort by either party and probably even the interest groups to get people to turn out and vote. Let me use an example. One of my really good friends was the campaign chair, I should say, for Essex County, New Jersey. And he made his staff go out and canvass. And they're really close friends of mine. And after that election, one of my friends said, "Doc, I really didn't have to canvass in this election. People were jumping out the doors. We didn't do anything." And so that idea of self-motivation and the zeitgeist of participating in an historic election got people out, but it doesn't mean that they were mobilized. And if they hadn't been mobilized in 2008 and they're not mobilized in 2010, then chances are they're probably not going to turn out and vote in this particular election, regardless of the facts of how critical this election is. The other issue is that Obama's coattails are short. They were proven short here in Georgia in 2008, but they're even shorter for cheap imitations of him. And so if we think about elections where you would figure that the idea of having a black president has made people more comfortable with the idea of black candidacies, we've seen that notion fallen short in this particular election. So I hate to put in a cheap plug for my edited volume called Who's Black Politics? Cases in Post-Racial Black Leadership, but I will proceed to do so. I've argued in that book that Obama represents one stream of black politics. And so the idea that came forward in the popular media that we had entered a post-racial wave of black politics where certain types of deracialized black candidates were now going to replace the old militant, old guard of black leadership is just not true. There are younger militant folks who were there and really to argue and contest the nature of African American politics going forward. But in particular, those who represent different streams and who bring different political resources to bear and then try to act like Barack Obama will not have viable candidacies. So in 2008, when Markell Hutchins actually literally tried to don the mantle of Obama by taking over his office space to run against John Lewis, he was rebuffed pretty resoundingly. This year, when Thurbert Baker tried to ride the Obama wave to the Democratic nomination for the governor of Georgia, he was soundly rebuffed because he's not Barack Obama. And similarly, Kendrick Meek, trying to ride the Obama wave to the U.S. Senate from Florida, has experienced many troubles in addition to the fact that Charlie Crist decided to run as an independent. And so that's really important to keep in mind that not everybody who is black is like Barack Obama, and thus they don't have the same advantages when they come to the table. Second of all, the idea of the breakthrough really calls into question what we understand about deracialized or race-neutral campaign tactics. The success of deracialization hinges on being able to maintain extremely high levels of support in the African American community with high levels of turnout amongst blacks while still being able to reach out and win enough white votes to be able to create a multiracial coalition. People who tried to use the Obama strategy in 2010 fell short this year, in part not because they weren't able to reach out to white voters, but in part they weren't able to maintain ties within their African American base. So for instance, in Washington, D.C., Adrian Fenty lost to Vincent Gray because black voters in Washington, D.C. were very dissatisfied with his leadership despite the strides he had made on education and crime in the city. Similarly, in Alabama, Archer Davis voted against health care, angered his black constituency, and had very strained relationships with the black political establishment in Alabama, and they chose to endorse his white opponent in this particular race. These are examples of the failure of deracialization, and they only underscore the theoretical critiques that were levied 20 years ago against this particular strategy. So we should look for cues within the Obama administration not only to predict his impact and his influence in this particular race, but also to predict his chances and the challenges that he himself is going to face in 2012. So while Obama doesn't really have to worry about losing black support at this point, he maintains his highest approval rates amongst African American voters, he should be concerned about the enthusiasm of that support. He should be worried that blacks are not going to turn out in large numbers in this election and that they won't turn out in as large numbers in 2012 unless he is seriously threatened. And it's also critical that President Obama continually cultivate the support amongst African Americans. I have to tell you a little story in closing about a call that I was a part of on Tuesday. So if you get emails from Organizing for America, maybe you got this an email invitation from Martin Luther King III to be part of this call about black voter turnout on Tuesday. I'm still trying to figure out how the Obama campaign knew I was black, but I know how they did. So anyhow, I got on this call, and if you've ever been a part of, I guess, a Ponzi scheme call where they have the Tuesday night pep rally meetings for everybody, if you've done Amway or anything like this, this call was very much like an Amway call to the point that it was very disturbing to me. And one by one, civil rights leader after preacher after Democratic leader got on the phone to urge African Americans to get out and vote. And then at the end of the call, they actually said you could press 1 if you wanted to volunteer for the campaign. So one, there's a lot that's actually very disturbing about the setup of this particular call. First of all, it sounded very much like a robotic call. So if you wanted this to increase voter turnout, robotic calls have been shown to not work in increasing voter turnout. The second issue is that if this call was done to rally the masses to go out and work for candidates in the last week before the election, I wasn't actually convinced that the quality of the call was actually going to be appropriate. Everyone who spoke was over the age of 40, while the church was very well represented amongst the speakers. There were people from other sectors of the African American community who were not well represented on this call, and I wasn't quite sure that it actually resonated with their target audience. And thirdly and finally, if Organizing for America and Obama and the Democratic Party are still trolling for black volunteers a week before an election, that's very serious. They should have had these volunteers lined up a month ago, which means that this mobilization campaign is half-hearted and it got started late, and that doesn't bode well for them on Tuesday. So I will end with that, and I look forward to your questions.